Good morning. Welcome you to our service this morning at St. Albans First Congregational Church. I'm glad it is to gather together to worship the Lord on this day. As we begin, call your attention to the announcements that are in the bulletin and on the insert. Please take note of each of those announcements and important information in there. And I have two announcements to make on Jacob's behalf regarding the women's gatherings. One is regarding the women's gatherings. The sign-up sheet for January for the ladies' group is on the clipboard. And as always, all the ladies are invited and encourage you to stop by and sign up for one group or all three of the events that are scheduled. And then also, I've got a request from you as well. Jamie and I have volunteered to do the coffee hour on January 22nd, and we're looking for somebody to help us with that. So, if somebody, individual or a couple, is willing to work with us on that, just let me know. I believe that's all the announcements I have. I know Wade has an announcement to make this morning as well.
Good morning. I'm Wade Smith, and I am a trustee on the nominating committee. Our committee will begin the nominating process on Wednesday, January 18th, for volunteers to serve the church. Those acceptance will be voted on in our annual meeting. If any of you would like to serve, or if you have recommendations, see members, please see any members of the nominating committee, which are Don Collins, Nancy Holland, Judy McQuarrie, Gene Miller, or myself. Thank you.
One program note for worship this morning. You will notice in your bulletin after the invitation to worship, the song Silent Night, which was to be played by Mary Ham. Unfortunately, she's not able to be with us this morning, so we'll skip over that this morning, and hopefully in a week or two she'll be here and be able to play that for us. So let us join together in our opening hymn, number 143, We Two Humans, where we are.
Thank you. O God, we come before you as the people gathered to behold Christ, a light of God that cannot be extinguished. In this new year, we offer special thanks for this community of faith and your faithful presence. Help us to see your glory, your glorious light, that we know in our hearts your reign on earth, and dedicate our lives to your service. We pray in the name of the one whom we call Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Did you know all the gifts for Christmas this last Christmas? You did. What kind of things did you get? You forgot already. It's only been 2 weeks ago. Okay. Did you give any gifts for Christmas to somebody else? You did. Okay. Where does this tradition of giving gifts come from? You know?
Scripture reading is Isaiah chapter 63, verses 7 through 9. I will recount the steadfast love of the Lord, the praises of the Lord, according to all the Lord has granted us, and the great goodness to the house of Israel, which he has granted them, according to his mercy, according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he said, surely they are my people, sons who will not deal falsely. And he became their Savior. In all their affliction he was afflicted, and the angel of his presence saved them. In his love and in his pity he redeemed them. He lifted them up and carried them all the day. chapter 2, verses 1 through 16. Now when Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he who has been born, King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east, and have come to worship him." When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it is written by the prophet, 'And you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who will govern my people Israel.'" Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word, that I too may come and worship him." When they had heard the king, they went their way, and lo, the star which they had seen in the east went before them, till it came to rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary his mother, and they fell down and worshipped him. Then, opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed. They departed to their own country by another way. Now when they had departed, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream and said, "Rise, take the child and his mother and flee to Egypt, and remain there till I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to destroy him." And he rose and took the child and his mother by night and departed to Egypt and remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill what the Lord had spoken by the prophet, "Out of Egypt have I called my son." Then Herod, when he saw that he had been tricked by the wise men, was in a furious rage, and he sent and killed all the male children in Bethlehem and in all that region who were 2 years old or under, according to the time which he had ascertained from the wise men. Here ends this morning's readings. May God add his blessing to our understanding of these words.
Epiphany actually is on the 6th of January. But we typically celebrate it on the Sundays closest to that day. Now, Epiphany comes from the Greek word epiphania, which means manifestation or appearance. And so on this day, we celebrate the appearance of God in the world in the human form of Jesus Christ. But it's also been associated with the arrival of the Magi, who also saw the appearance or manifestation of the star that heralded the birth of the King of the Jews. Now, typically, traditionally, in our celebrations of Christmas, we set up a creche or a manger scene, like the one that we have in the front of a church and have had all Christmas season. Now, ever since the time of St. Francis of Assisi, have we even been doing such things as this? St. Francis was the first one to display a manger scene. Of course, his was with real people and live animals. And that first one was displayed in the year 1223 in the Italian city of Brescia, and he had the permission of Pope Honorius III to do that. Now, what motivated St. Francis to start this, what has become a tradition, was a recent visit of his to the Holy Land and the experience of visiting the traditional site for the birth of our Savior. Now, as we set things up, well, one of the key purposes of them is to remind us of the humble circumstances in which our Savior was born, as well as to recognize those visitors that came to the Savior. And we typically include the wise men as part of those visitors on the night that Jesus was born. And yet it's highly unlikely that they came at that particular moment in time. Based on what we read in Matthew this morning, it could have taken up to 2 years for them to arrive from wherever in, quote, the east that they came from. And so it's very unlikely that the wise men, the Magi, never came to the stable itself. Because by the time they arrived, this little family had left the stable and had moved into a house. There is one character, though, that we never see in the manger scene and that we never see in a children's Christmas pageant. And that character happens to be King Herod. Even though he doesn't appear in either of those ways that we celebrate Christmas, he certainly is an important part of the Christmas story. Now, he's referred to as King Herod, but he certainly wasn't really a king in the normal sense of the word. King was a title that he gave to himself. He was actually a provincial ruler that was appointed by Caesar Augustus, and the only power that he had was whatever power Caesar Augustus invested in him. And of course, we have the details of all of that in Matthew chapter 2. We see, obviously, here that the wise men, the Magi,
Jerusalem, at the palace of this king, seeking directions to find out where it is that this one whose sorrow they saw was to be born. While summoning the Hebrew chief priests and teachers of the law, Herod determines from them that it was to be born in Bethlehem. And so he sends these magi off to Bethlehem with the charge that when they find him, to come back to him and tell him so that he too might go and pay homage. And the magi, leaving Herod's palace, heading for the Bethlehem Stadium, is where we usually quit on this reading of the story of the coming of the Magi. Unfortunately, these visitors from the east were smart enough to realize that Herod was trying to use them as spies. And it's for that reason that they decided to take a different route home, because they didn't want to be involved in Herod's plot. But the story itself doesn't end with their leaving to go back to their homeland. There's a second chapter to this story. And that second chapter is what's contained in verses 13 through 16. Where we are told that an angel appeared to Joseph in a dream and told him to take Mary and Jesus to Egypt because Herod was trying to seek to kill him. And that portion of the story goes on to tell us that when Herod realized that the Magi had tricked him, that he sent a legion of soldiers to Bethlehem and the surrounding area to slaughter all the male Hebrew babies that were 2 years old or younger, based upon the time that the Magi reported that they saw the star. And this is why we say that it is very possible that it might have taken them 2 years to arrive at Bethlehem. Now, Herod's primary responsibility as provincial ruler was to do the dirty work of the emperor by subduing this colony that tended to be particularly rebellious. And that was a job that Herod enjoyed, because Herod was a very vile and ruthless individual. Now, during the 41 years of his reign, he had at least 9 wives and 14 children. And history bears out the fact that he executed one of his wives for adultery. And he used her mother as his chief witness in the trial. And her mother testified against her simply because she too feared for her life. Well, after her daughter had been executed, this mother, Herod's mother-in-law, claimed the position of queen. And she began accusing Herod of being mentally unstable and not fit to rule in this capacity. And because of that, she too was executed, this time without a trial. Still feeling rather insecure and threatened, Herod also executed 2 of his sons, who happened to have been born to this woman, his wife, because he considered them as threats to him as well. And then a little while later, probably guess what happened. He too became jealous of this son. They put him on trial for treason. And he also was executed. Well, at this particular point in time, Emperor Augustus became so infuriated with Herod that Augustus refused to allow any of his other sons to claim the title of king over this region. But finally, Herod passed away, and this kingdom then was divided into three different sections. Each one of those three sections governed by one of his three sons remaining. And they served more the role of tetrarch, even in provincial ruler. And it was through these sons of the division of the kingdom that Herod finally got his vengeance against this one who was born to be king of the Jews and who was a threat to him. 33 years later, after Herod's death, his one son, Herod Antipas, would see Jesus standing before him in chains with a crown of thorns. Thankfully, on that day so long ago, God intervened to save the life of Jesus by sending the vision of his angel Joseph and instructing him to take them to the good. Sadly, as well, there were countless numbers of other babies that were slaughtered. And some of us certainly might feel rather troubled by the fact that God spared the life of Jesus while he allowed those other children to die and those families to suffer. Well, that certainly raises the question, the ongoing question, of the problem of suffering and pain in the world. And that's a philosophical and theological question that's been debated for centuries upon centuries, and there are no easy answers to it. But one thing that this portion of the story tells us is that we certainly can see, because of Herod's ruthlessness, that he had the capability to dispatch soldiers to kill babies. And that all in all perhaps makes us question the words of Isaiah that we've also heard this morning. Isaiah speaks of the kindness of the Lord. I tell you the kindness of the Lord, the deeds for which he is to be praised. Is there really kindness in the fact that God allows people to suffer? But yet, Isaiah also speaks to remind us that even in the midst of suffering, because Isaiah makes no attempt to deal with this question of suffering, but he does remind us that God declares, "Surely they are my people, children who will be true to me." And so he became their savior. In verse 9 in particular, in all their distress, he too was distressed. And the angel of his presence saved them. In his love and mercy, he redeemed them. He lifted them up and carried them all days long. No, Eric isn't included in our Christmas pageants or in our friendships. And that certainly is the right thing to do by not including him. But still, he's an important part of the Christmas message. Because he reminds us of the kind of world that we live in and why this world still needs a Savior today. We may have all had a fine Christmas, but there are plenty of our neighbors whose lives are tainted with suffering. And those neighbors may be right next door, or they may be halfway across the world. There are children who die on a daily basis for lack of food. Children and parents who wander the streets because they have no place to live. There are mothers and children who are beaten and abused. There are families fleeing their homeland as refugees because of civil war. There are young girls who are kidnapped and sold into the sex trafficking trade. Plenty of suffering. Plenty of suffering. But I say to you that Jesus did not come to bring us a midwinter festival of peace and contentment. I also say to you that Jesus was not born into a serene Christmas card scene. He was born to be the Savior of the world. And that was his mission. So our role as disciples today, and indeed disciples who may very well be weary from the celebration of another Christmas, our role is to carry out that mission of bringing salvation to the world. And we do that by using the spiritual and the material gifts that we have been given. We hear so much every Christmas season about keeping Christ in Christmas. But I don't think that Christ is really in danger of losing his position in Christmas. At least not because of the secularism and consumerism, which has swallowed up a good portion of this holiday. I think the greater danger is that we will lose the significance of Christmas if we, as believers, neglect this ministry and mission of salvation that's been entrusted to us. If we are not busy proclaiming the good news, then indeed, it's highly possible that Christ will lose his position of prominence in this celebration. So rather than simply seeking to keep Christ in Christmas, I think we need to keep Herod in Christmas. And we need to keep him in Christmas because he helps us to remember that the ministry of salvation is the mission that we have committed. Amen. as we begin our joys and concerns this morning, I'm going to ask for your continued prayers for Jamie. Some of you know, many of you probably don't know, that I had had her to the emergency room on Wednesday afternoon. She had a very sudden onset, severe headache, and another severe dizzy spell. The good news is, after running some tests, they found nothing that would indicate any prior or current stroke or anything of that nature. But they did say she is suffering from severe vertigo. So she hasn't, since then she's had some good days and bad days, and put her on some medication. And this morning she could barely get out of bed. So just ask for your prayers for her. Hopefully we'll get some resolution on this. What other joys or concerns do you have this morning?
Joy is that since my relationship with my family, they've got a lot of happening, and I just wanted to say that from the initial time that I brought AJ here to the time that I'm experiencing now, the church has been really wonderful. It started with unknown people doing things, giving things, following, traveling distances, people connecting with me. It is culminating in an event this Friday the 13th at Twix, an adult evening. It's all culminating in an infusion of passion for the family, which is desperately needed. And I just want to take the opportunity to thank the church and all the people of us. Well, the church, the people are the church. I was amazed. I'm just the bearer of the news, and I think that the family has
been a great work.
Appreciate it.
How are you? Truth be within each of us, that we might experience Lord, we pray that you would help us to live in the spirit of Christmas each day, remembering that we have been tasked with the mission and ministry of bringing the salvation of Jesus Christ to everyone in this world. And we do that with our words, we do that with our actions, we do that by coming together as your people to make a difference in the communities in which we live. And so this day we join with David in praise and thanksgiving for the power of your Spirit and the way you have been working in the life of AJ and his family. This little boy has become a treasure to us in this congregation. And we give you thanks, Lord, that you have moved us to help support not only David as he mentors this child, but to help support and encourage and witness through the love of Jesus Christ to this family who has experienced a great deal of suffering recently. Remind us that that's what ministry is all about, that's what our faith is all about. That we need to do more than simply come to worship and sit in our pews and go away unchanged. But we need to come to worship, to listen for your voice, to sense the leading of your Spirit, and then go out and do something to make a difference in the world or the life of someone else. So we pray for your guidance as we see you this day. Lord, we lift our prayers for Jamie this morning. I thank you, Lord, that the test results of the hospital the other day showed no signs of anything serious. But she is continuing to struggle with a severe burden of it. And so we pray for your intervention, for your hand in communion, that you would take this dizziness away, and that you would help her to function normally again in her life. We lift our prayers for so many others, Lord, that have not been named this morning, who suffer from a variety of afflictions, who have lost loved ones, who are lonely and hurting, and your Spirit be present with each other. And may your Spirit be with them through us as we seek to do whatever we can do in the name of Jesus Christ. We thank you for calling us to be your people, for calling us to worship this day, and for sending us out to do your will. And in all things, we give you thanks and joy and praise as we pray together the words that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our whole selves, body, mind, so he calls us to bring these gifts as an offering. An offering of joy. Giving thanks to God for the gifts that he's given to us, and especially the gift of his Son, Jesus Christ. So let us bring before God our tithes and our offering.
This is the day that the Lord has made, as the psalmist
we will rejoice and be glad in you. Each and every day is a gift from God. A new beginning. A new opportunity to serve and to love others with the same everlasting love with which God loves us. So go this day to be people of love, to witness to the salvation that is ours because of Jesus, as you reach out to those who need. And know that as you do this, the blessing of God